Hi everyone, in this video we will talk about content security policy bypass. Therefore, I want to start the video by asking you the following question. Do you think the following content security policy is safe? And the CSP I'm referring to is the following one. So we have a script source directive with a nonce value. We have a style source directive with self and a nonce value. And finally, we have a default source directive with a wildcard. So, do you think this CSP is safe or it misses something? So, in this video, we will analyze a web challenge name cloud recipe taken from the nd4SUS CTF 2025. Here is the CTF time link and here is the official write-up. In the challenge, we will learn how to bypass a weakly configured CSP by using the base HTML element. And I've actually prepared a Docker image for the challenge, so here you can see that I've just started the Docker image, so we can just open the browser here, open browser with Bird Suite, and I can go into localhost 5000, and here I have access to the challenge itself. Here I'm gonna put burp, and of course in this challenge we also have the source code, so it's gonna be source code analysis and dynamic testing. So first things first, let's analyze the files of the challenge. If you run a simple tree, we see there is a single app.py, some static assets like a JavaScript and a bunch of templates. So of course the juice here is the app.py. Now in the app.py, we can see that it implements a CSP, a content security policy, using Talisman. So this wraps over Flask, basically. Now what even is a CSP? Basically, a content security policy is a policy implemented by the browser in order to tell the browser what kind of assets and resources to load and where to load them from. Because the idea is that the browser by its own is able to interpret HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and a lot of other files like, you know, PNGs, images, stuff like that. So a bunch of assets the browser is able to interpret and display to the end user. Now, this can become a problem. For example, in the case of cross-site scripting, XSS, what is the basic idea? The basic idea is that a malicious actor is able to introduce malicious JavaScript within the browser. Now, since the browser is designed to execute any JavaScript it sees, when it sees the malicious JavaScript, of course, it's also gonna execute that JavaScript. So, in order to mitigate the risk associated with XSS, in order to reduce the threats associated with malicious JavaScript code, browser implementers develop this policy called CSP, which basically allows the browser to have a more fine-grained control over which resources to load. For example, we can say, okay, you can load all the JavaScript that come from this site, example.com, but only from example.com. For example, we can use a CSP to say, you shall not execute inline JavaScript. So inline JavaScript, for example, just a tag script and something else, right? Like, I don't know, alert something. Now, this is inline JavaScript, and of course, it's pretty dangerous if you think about it, because a malicious actor is going to try to inject such inline JavaScript into the page. So, yes, the CSP is used exactly for this reason. And here we can see the configuration using Talisman. So, in the app.py, we see this, and it's a key portion of the challenge. Now, another thing of interest is where is the flag? It is a CTF, so there must be a flag. Now, in this case, the flag is taken from the environment and it is put in the cookie of a headless browser. So in this case, the headless browser that we're using is through the Playwright library. So Playwright, here we're gonna define our Chromium instance. So this is headless, it means that it runs as a simple process. It does not have anything graphical, headless true. And notice that we are adding this cookie with the flag, with the flag value. And also notice that this cookie has HTTP only false. This means that any JavaScript that is injected in this headless Chromium instance will be able to access that flag, that cookie essentially. So, for example, what does this method do, which is the one that actually introduces this? Well, actually, this method is used to visit a specific page of the application. Now, what does this application do? Well, this application can be used to login, register, and create recipes. So, for example, let's register a simple username. So, test, test, test. So, here we have our username, and here we can create a recipe. So, we have our recipe, create recipe, and we have report recipe, right? So we can create a recipe, we're gonna say test test, and here we can also upload an image, but we don't care about that for now. We're just gonna say create recipe, and look at this, we have our recipe. Now we can view it, so this is gonna be the recipe viewed, and then we can say report recipe. Now send your delicious recipe to the administrator. So this one is gonna be used to spawn that headless Chromium instance and analyze that recipe. So here we put the ID, we say send to admin, we wait a little bit, and here it's essentially said the admin has viewed your recipe. So the app is pretty simple. So, and as you can see, this admin bot visit is the one that is used when we say recipe ID sent to admin, because essentially it's gonna spawn a headless instance and it's gonna visualize the page like this /admin/recipe/recipe ID. For example, if we go into /admin/recipe/1, we're gonna say access denied, okay, because we don't have the cookie. We don't have a special value that only has this particular instance. So this is a critical point of the challenge, of course. Now let's continue. Here we have, so this is the endpoint that the headless Chromium instance will see when we say send to admin, basically. And as you can see here, it tries to get this XBot token, and if it doesn't find it, it's gonna say access denied. Otherwise, it's gonna make a query and it's gonna actually render the template. So it's gonna say recipe.html recipe equal recipe. So when we click on that send to admin, what's gonna happen is that the admin bot visit will execute. Now, what does it do? Well, as we saw previously, this one will just load a page of the website. And specifically, it will load this /admin/recipe with the specific recipe ID, with this particular cookie which contains the flag. Now, is there a way in which we can trigger a cross-site scripting over this particular page? Can we control some kind of input that is then displayed into this page? Well, we also saw this code, and at the end we say render template. So how is this template constructed? Let's analyze this recipe.html. If we analyze the recipe.html, we can see that within the page, we see this auto escape false blocks. So here there is one essentially auto escape, and here we're putting the title and the description. So notice the auto escape false. This means that we can actually inject arbitrary HTML tags, including JavaScript, by using the title and description fields of the recipe. So how do we do that? Well, we can create an environment. So here I showed how to create it without Docker, but actually then I created a Docker. So you can just use the Docker file that is available and you can just run the Docker itself. So basically here we can create an account, which we have, we can create a recipe. But now in this recipe, let's put some JavaScript. So how do we do that? Well, for example, we can say test 2, and then we can put image source on error alert 1, and then we say create recipe. Now, when we go and analyze the recipe itself, it's also gonna render the same template. Now, this URL is not the one that the admin sees, right? But it's similar, because if you actually go into the code, into the challenge itself, so app.py, and we go into recipe, recipe D, so like recipe D, this one. So notice that in the first one, it's not admin. So this is one that the user sees. So this is for the user, while this is for the admin. But what we care about, to be honest, ultimately, is the final thing. It's the render template. And we're rendering the same template with the same piece of data. Because when we execute this query, we're executing over the same database. Therefore, we're getting the same thing. The difference is that we cannot view this because this requires like an admin token that only the headless instance has. But with respect to the challenge itself, we can totally test out JavaScript execution within this page, this recipe.html. So if we analyze here, if we analyze the DOM that we created from this page here, we just zoom in here, notice that actually we have introduced the image source X on error alert one. So we have introduced this element. However, we did not see any JavaScript execution. Why is that? Well, if we go into the console, we see the reason why, essentially. So it failed to load the image, which is intended, because that kind of payload is meant to, so that the image fails to load and that the on error script is executed, right? But then we actually have this other line: refuse to execute inline event handler because it violates the following content security policy directive: script source nonce. So basically, the idea, what the browser is saying, is that I tried to execute the JavaScript, but I couldn't because of CSP, because the CSP did not allow me to execute the JavaScript. So that's the idea. And at this point, we have to understand how can we bypass this check. So here I show how to register an account, how to create the recipe with the image source on error alert. However, if we go into the page, we see the error that I showed. So we see this error. So basically, the problem is this content security policy. So look at this. We have script source, style source. Here, basically, we are not allowed to use inline JavaScript. Therefore, that payload, image source, on error, this one, simply does not work. Does not work because it is inline JavaScript. So is this a CSP enough, however? And we can actually use this evaluator. So we're gonna copy it here. Gonna open this link, we're gonna copy the security policy. This is from Google, it's a CSP evaluator. We can just paste the CSP in here, we can check the CSP, and notice what it says. So in the default source, it says you should not allow wildcard as source, so this is not good. And also it says missing base URI, allows the injection of base tags. They can be used to set the base URL for all relative script URLs to an attacker control domain. Can you set it to none or self? So basically it's telling us that there's a misconfiguration that's going on here. And this misconfiguration has to do with the base URI directive. Now, what is the base HTML tag? And here we can see an example: base href target blank. So the base HTML element specify a base URL and or target URL for all relative URLs in a document. For example, consider the page that we analyzed, this one. The question is there a relative URL within this page? Well, if we analyze the source code, we go down and we see, look at this. So this URL is relative. Why? Because it starts with a slash. Here, we do not specify the full domain. We don't specify the full URL. We are omitting the domain. We are assuming that the domain is one of the website, right? However, if we introduce a base element, this one is actually going to change and it's going to use the href attribute of the base element. It's going to use the base element to create the final URL. And this, of course, can allow for the injection of malicious scripts. So basically the idea, are there any relative URLs? Yes, there are. And with this, we actually have all our elements for a solution. Why? Let's put all the pieces together. So we have the flag in the cookie with HTTP only equal to false. This means that we can exfiltrate this flag using XSS. Then we can force the browser of the admin to visit the page with the recipe. And we can control the title and description of the recipe, which allows us to inject arbitrary HTML elements. Now, with these three elements, we are still not good because it's not enough to inject JavaScript. However, we can bypass the content security policy with the base element. And we can force, essentially, to load the image.js from an attacker controller site. It means that we can force the browser to load our malicious JavaScript. And so the actual solution is therefore described. First, we will create a malicious server which will host a malicious JavaScript within the path static.js image.js. The JS payload will exfiltrate the cookie using a typical fetch payload. Then, to trigger the execution of the JavaScript, we will create a recipe with a malicious base HTML tag. And finally, we will force the browser of the administrator to view such recipe page, the page with our malicious base tag. Given that the CSP has been misconfigured, the browser will not complain about the injected base element and will trigger the loading of the image.js asset from our malicious server. So how do we create a malicious server? We can actually use these commands. We're going to create with makedir-p to create multiple directories, so www.static.js. We're going to echo all the JavaScript payload itself into the image.js, and notice this is a very simple fetch payload in which we put the cookie within the body. So pretty simple, document.cookie. Remember that the cookie has HTTP only equal to false. Therefore, we can access it with the document.cookie. Here, the only thing that we need to change is actually this URL, because we need to put, with burp, we need to put a good collaborator. So I'm going to start the collaborator. I'm going to put copy to clipboard. So I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. And here we are as good as new. So just going to do this. Perfect. Then I'm going to go into www and I'm going to start the HP server at port 1337. Then I need to create the malicious recipe. Notice this malicious recipe here. It's the post-create recipe. And I put in the title test, in the description, I put the base element. So basically I can do this as follows. I'm going to create a new recipe. I'm going to say test. And then I'm going to put this base URL exactly right here. And notice the base element has an href attribute with value HTTP localhost 1337, which points to our malicious server. What, of course, in the challenge itself, we would need to have a public reachable server, like a server with a public IP address, like some kind of VPS or service like that. So here we say crea ricetta, so like create the recipe. And now we have created this third recipe, this test recipe, right? So the final thing to do is we just need to force the admin to view the recipe. So we're going to say report recipe. Here we're going to put recipe ID 3, which is the third recipe we created. And when the admin sees the recipe, it's actually going to execute our malicious script. So to actually see that this is the case, let's see if we see some fetches within our malicious server. So we send this to the admin. Notice that we get a 200 request, a get request for the image.js asset. And now if we do poll now here, notice that we get some interaction with our callback server. Within the interaction, we can just like do this, and look at this, we have the flag. We have the flag and we manage to solve the challenge. So here I have some reference to the CTF time event, the official write-up, and the evaluator for the content security policy. What did we learn in this video? We learned that policies such as this one are not secure because they do not cover the base URI directive. Since they do not cover the base URI directive, it becomes possible to inject a base HTML element, such as the following one. If a malicious actor is able to inject such element within the page, and if the page contains a relative resource, like basically this one, static.js image, then a malicious actor is able to inject arbitrary JavaScript code within the page. Because basically, he just have to expose a malicious server with this specific asset, static.js image.js. He can put whatever he wants within that file. And when the browser sees the base directive and sees this relative, it's going to do base plus relative. So it's going to do base plus relative. And it's going to load the malicious JavaScript directly from the attacker, which leads to, of course, the execution of malicious JavaScript. So I hope this video was fun. I hope in this video you learned a little bit about content security policy and how you can bypass it via the base element. And this is why you need to put the base URI directive. If you are insecure about your CSP, you can always check out a CSP evaluator such as the Google ones, which gives you like some simple tips and tricks to handle it better, essentially. Like for example, base URI missing, this is a security threat. So I hope the video was fun, and to the next video.